Hi, this is Dr. Max Fung, University of California, Davis in Sacramento, California. Over the many years that I've given lectures on interface dermatitis, I've followed the interface page on Wikipedia and marveled at the many definitions of interfaces. Most recently, learning about the last item on this page, the audio interface, after setting up a recording studio in my daughter's bedroom. But if we drill down or expand in the area of science and healthcare, medicine, and dermatopathology, there are actually some business and administrative aspects where interfaces are critical, specifically HL7 type electronic interfaces to transmit pathology reports to the client, the outside dermatology practice. And consistent with the referral-based nature of many dermpath practices, an interface engine to transmit multiple reports from the lab to multiple different client EHRs, sometimes on the orders of hundreds daily. But of course, today's session is dedicated to medical knowledge, that of interface dermatitis, one of 10 major patterns of inflammatory disease that we'll be covering in our one-year curriculum. So the interface of interface dermatitis refers specifically to the interface of epidermis and dermis, the dermal epidermal junction, or DEJ, which is a basement membrane zone between the epidermis and dermis, and by extension, the adnexal, follicular, and eccrine epithelium and adjacent periepithelial or periadnexal stroma within the dermis. In the diagram of the skin that we reviewed in the introductory lecture, we can see that the junction involves the epidermis and the papillary dermis. So the inflammation is going to be centered along this undulating reedy ridge pattern of the DEJ, with inflammation emanating from the vessels of the upper dermis, primarily involving the papillary dermis, variably obscuring the DE junction, depending on the amount of inflammation and associated changes. And the dermatitis component, as with any itis in medicine, reflects the inflammation, specifically with interface dermatitis, typically lymphocytes and epidermal changes mediated by lymphocytes and sometimes associated with other cell types. Minimal or essential histologic criteria for interface dermatitis are essentially twofold. The first feature that is expected in any example of interface dermatitis would be the presence of junctional vacuoles, also referred to as junctional vacuolar alteration, manifesting histologically as small, empty, or white-appearing circular spaces at the dermal epidermal junction. And these are thought to represent the artifact left behind by edema fluid. So somewhat analogous to the widened spaces in between adjacent keratinocytes in spongiosis, collection of fluid at the junction manifests as junctional vacuolar alteration. But it's been said, because it's probably true, that if you look hard enough at any H&E section of skin, you can probably find one or even a few junctional vacuoles. So that in and of itself is not entirely specific. The other feature that we like to see in interface dermatitis are necrotic keratinocytes, somewhat affectionately known as dead reds. But of course, not all dermatopathologists in the history of dermatopathology have been so casual with their terminology, so there are many different terms associated with these necrotic keratinocytes in addition to the catchy dead reds. So in terms of pathogenesis in interface dermatitis, in examples where it's been studied rigorously, it's actually apoptosis or programmed cell death that is the mechanism of necrosis. In other instances, such as acantholytic dyskeratosis, it's felt to be an abnormal differentiation, and so the terms dyskeratosis or dismaturation can be applied. And sometimes there can simply be a physical insult or ischemic necrosis that tends to result in more widespread or confluent necrosis. And then finally, we have the many bodies, savate bodies, colloid bodies, cytoid bodies, cytoids, hyaline bodies. These are all different names for necrotic keratinocytes, although when these terms are applied, it usually reflects the fact that the necrotic keratinocytes have been secondarily coated with immunoglobulin as part of this interface reaction pattern. And so this can sometimes be demonstrated on direct immunofluorescence, usually IgM, or IgA, and this reflects a secondary alteration on top of the necrotic keratinocytes that's characteristic of certain disorders, for example, lichen planus as a prototype. And morphologically, these necrotic keratinocytes and savant bodies manifest as eosinophilic globules, similar or sometimes slightly larger in size as adjacent keratinocytes, and they can be at or sometimes slightly above or below the dermal epidermal junction. In the diagnostic approach to interface dermatitis, a variety of aspects may be considered. Typically and traditionally, at low power, we would assess the pattern of inflammation. Secondarily, the epidermal changes associated with the inflammatory pattern. And then finally, the nature of the inflammatory infiltrate itself. As I mentioned, lymphocytes are always present, but sometimes the presence or absence of eosinophils, neutrophils, or other cells can refine one's differential diagnosis. Personally, I tend to go reflexively first to the eosinophils, not only their presence, but also their absence. So we'll talk a little bit later about the so-called no eos rule. I think it must have been the late A. Bernard Ackerman who was the most successful proponent of the vacuolar and lichenoid patterns of interface dermatitis. This would be the first diagnostic branch point in assessing the pattern. We can see on the left, we have the vacuolar alteration, and so we see these empty or white appearing vacuoles collecting along the dermal epidermal junction. And then with the lichenoid infiltrate, we do have the vacuolar alteration still, but it's not as prominent because there's a lot of inflammation obscuring it. So we have more of a dense or band-like infiltrate that is also synonymously referred to as a lichenoid infiltrate because it is typical of lichen planus, which is lichenoid for clinical reasons, but that term has been translated over to the histology. So if we see that band-like or dense pattern of inflammation that's typical of lichen planus, we simply refer to this infiltrate as lichenoid, even if the condition has nothing else to do with lichen planus. And so with that, doing your very, very best to suppress your bias of recent experience, what is your diagnosis? Trainees, pause and diagnose. As I think many of you would have suspected, this is a good clinical example of lichen planus characterized by papules coalescing into plaques, often in polygonal shape and flat topped with a reticulated white surface, Wickham's striae. Microscopically, biopsies of lichen planus are characterized by a dense band-like lymphocytic infiltrate with characteristic epidermal changes, which include compact orthokeratosis, a prominent granular layer or hypergranulosis, and irregular epidermal hyperplasia with alteration of the reedy ridge pattern. With a characteristic jagged or sawtooth shape to the reedy ridges. I think one of the more peculiar concepts in interface dermatitis is that of squamatization of the basal layer, which essentially reflects a premature terminal differentiation of keratinocytes. So remember that in normal skin, the basal layer of keratinocytes is more or less cuboidal in shape, kind of like over here on the lower right-hand side of this diagram. They're fairly cuboidal, and as keratinocytes differentiate into the spinous layer and then into the granular keratinocytes, which contain those basophilic keratohyaline granules, normally flatten out just prior to terminal differentiation or cornification. And so to see basal layer keratinocytes that have a flattened profile similar to that of granular keratinocytes is abnormal, and it's characteristic of a subset of lichenoid reactions, with lichen planus being the prototype. And again, the other characteristic features of lichen planus include compact orthokeratosis, the granular layer not only is prominent, but often exhibits a somewhat wedge-shaped profile. And now looking a little closer at the reedy ridge pattern, I'm going to refer back to Dr. Mark Goldine's diagram from the introductory lecture showing the more egg crate shaped pattern of the reedy ridges in contrast to the more jagged or sawtooth profile of the reedy ridges in lichen planus. Once again, at higher magnification. Looking closer still, savant bodies come into view. in terms of the inflammatory cells in lichen planus, like most forms of dermatitis, it's a predominantly lymphocytic infiltrate in a lichenoid pattern, and eosinophils are typically rare absent. So I've heard that some people would apply the no eos rule to lichen planus, but in my experience, that's not the case, although we don't expect them. So I would say that eosinophils are often rare or absent, but they can be present, but usually not in high numbers. And typically in lichen planus, there's a lack of deep dermal involvement, and this helps with the differential of lupus, drug reactions, and pityriasis lichenoides. And while lichen planus is not rare, but not very commonly encountered, probably far more commonly encountered is the lichenoid keratosis, or lichen planus-like keratosis, LPLK, or BLK, benign lichenoid keratosis. These are commonly biopsied because they present as solitary lesions in adults, and so the differential typically is with a non-melanoma skin cancer or actinic keratosis. Classically, these are solitary lesions on the chest or else the torso or extremities of adults. And if there's a single most common clue histologically, it's probably the presence of parakeratosis, at least focally, in most lichenoid keratoses that I see, in contrast to the compact orthokeratosis of lichen planus. But having said that, the clinical context is probably the single most predictive aspect. And so that can often be predicted simply by the fact that you have a shave specimen rather than a punch specimen, and then knowing that the solitary lesion, especially if it's classically on the chest, will instantly direct you towards lichenoid keratosis rather than a lichenoid dermatitis. Here is one clinical pathologic example of a lichenoid keratosis from my old residency days Kodachrome collection. We can see the lesion on the upper left-hand corner corresponding to the biopsy shown here at median magnification, with a lichenoid pattern of inflammation. Notice how it's a little bit more patchy. It's kind of more dense here, and then it's kind of more sparse here. We have a little bit of a suggestion of a sawtooth 3D pattern, but it's not as good as a classic lichen planus in other areas. For example, here on the left, the reedy ridges are more bulbous or club-shaped. And looking more superficially, we have hypergranulosis as expected. We have compact orthokeratosis. There also is only a smidgen in this field, a little bit of a suggestion of parakeratosis, which, as I mentioned, would be very typical of a lichenoid keratosis. But in a histologic context alone, it would be difficult to exclude lichenoid dermatitis in general, including lichen planus, so one needs clinical correlation. In the differential diagnosis of lichenoid dermatitis, in addition to a lichenoid keratosis, lichenoid drug is frequently considered. And truth be told, pathologists can never definitively confirm or exclude lichenoid drug for practical purposes. But there are histologic features that are said to be characteristic. So in contrast to the compact orthokeratosis of lichen planus, lichenoid drug reactions often exhibit parakeratosis. And in kind of a fun but still true fact, the presence of superficial savate bodies way high up in the stratum corneum has been associated with lichenoid drug reactions in contrast to lichen planus itself. And other more general features of drug reactions are always nice to see, so deep dermal involvement and also the presence of many eosinophils are typically supportive of a drug reaction. But in the end, clinical correlation is required. Experienced and or confident trainees, pause and diagnose. Lichen nidatus is characterized by innumerable pinpoint papules, usually in children, and this is reflected histologically in a very focal lichenoid infiltrate, so-called ball in claw profile. It's a lymphohistiocytic infiltrate, and it tends to have a fairly significant histiocytic component, almost granulomatous, although discrete granulomas should not be seen. And moreover, these histiocytes can have foamy cytoplasm. They can be relatively large or epithelioid or multinucleated. The ball and claw is actually referring to a style of furniture foot popularized by the English cabinet designer Thomas Chippendale in the 18th century, apparently referencing the dragon or a dragon's claw around a pearl. And in more modern times, we can see this robotic claw colored gray here, representing the inward bending reedy ridges surrounding the red ball of inflammation that is the focal lichenoid infiltrate. In lichenoiditis, the focal lichenoid lymphohistiocytic infiltrate abuts and variably obscures the dermal epidermal junction. There can be some secondary changes, such as perikeratosis and even apparent disruption of the epidermis. And at high magnification, we can see not only many small lymphocytes with scant cytoplasm, but also larger cells with abundant pale cytoplasm and larger pale nuclei consistent with histiocytes. And in this field, I would estimate that it's probably somewhat 50-50. So this is a little bit more histiocytic than your typical lichenoid lymphocytic infiltrate and almost has a granulomatous quality, although discrete granulomas are not present. This is characteristic of many examples of lichenoiditis. Moving forward, experienced trainees, pause and diagnose. Certainly it helps to have the bias of the context of interface and lichenoid dermatitis for this, but you may have recognized the distinctive periecrine lymphocytic infiltrate as typical of lichen striatus. Another fairly rare but distinctive pediatric form of lichenoid dermatitis that clinically manifests as linear plaques, generally following embryonic migration lines or lines of Blaschko. And histologically, there is a variable lichenoid pattern ranging from sparse to dense. And like lichenoiditis, sometimes the infiltrate has a prominent histiocytic or nearly granulomatous component. And histopathologic expression of lichen striatus is typically not pathognomonic, but if you're going to get it, the best histologic expression that you get would have a distinctive periecrine lymphocytic component. And if you have that combined with the pediatric setting and linear lesions, you're most of the way there to lichen striatus. Here's one example of clinically confirmed lichen striatus. And at first glance, one could consider, as did I, the possibility of lichenoiditis in that there is somewhat of an inward bending reedy ridge pattern resembling a ball and claw. But in this case, it's not a classic ball and claw. Certainly this may have been a relatively small papule, but we can see that the inflammatory infiltrate is not confined to a single interreedy space. There is extension beyond, so it actually spans maybe the three or four reedy ridges in width, so not a classic ball and claw. And again, we can see the inflammatory infiltrates abutting and variably obscuring the interface of the epidermis and dermis. We can see foci of lymphocyte exocytosis into the epidermis, as well as cells with more abundant cytoplasm consistent with a relatively prominent histiocytic component, as may also be seen in lichenoiditis. Moving on to another case, can you suggest a diagnosis from a single photomicrograph? And here's a closer look. And a little clinical pathologic correlation never hurts. Trainees, pause, diagnose. A nice case of lichenoid purpura, one of the variants of the pigmented purpuric dermatoses or pigmented purpuras. The lichenoid purpuras include lichenoid purpura of Gougereau and Bloom, as well as lichen aureus. And I think the point here is that one can lump or split these two entities. I'll leave that for a separate discussion, the merits of lumping or splitting these. But common features of lichenoid purpura include the presence of extravasated erythrocytes and the subsequent formation of siderophages or hemosiderin-laden macrophages that can be highlighted with a Peierls stain if needed. And the lichenoid component itself may be a little less prominent compared to other examples, so you may not see prominent vacuolar alteration or necrotic keratinocytes. There sometimes is a tendency for the infiltrate in lichenoid purpura to appear as a definite dense or band-like infiltrate, but to actually almost relatively spare the DEJ as if it were like a slight mini Grenz zone. There also is a typical lack of deep dermal involvement similar to lichen planus, again in contrast to your differential of lupus drug reaction or pityriasis lichenoides. in this example of lichen or purpura, we can see that there is a band-like infiltrate of inflammatory cells across the papillary dermis, but even from low magnification, the DEJ, the junction, is not really obscured. I can still kind of follow it pretty easily with my tracer. We don't see inflammation obscuring or blurring that linear dermal epidermal junction. And we can see that there's not a lot of deep dermal extension, although in this case there actually is some. I would say this is a little bit more than I typically see in the deep dermis for lichenoid purpura. And again, siderophages or hemosiderin, generally evident on H&E as kind of a yellow, gold, pale brown, highly refractile pigment in contrast to melanin. But if there's any doubt, one can do a pearl stain. Next case. Your diagnosis, scanning magnification alone, it's doable. With four examples for your clinical pathologic correlation. To make the diagnosis of pityriasis lichenoides, which encompasses a spectrum from acute to chronic lesions, pityriasis lichenoides et variolaformis acuta, or PLEVA, and pityriasis lichenoides chronica, PLC, characterized in all cases by a papular eruption with variable scale and crust, sometimes forming small but never large plaques or patches. As with other papular eruptions, such as arthropod bite reactions, the papular lesions of pityriasis lichenoides sometimes have a distinctive profile with the inverted wedge shape at scanning magnification. But in addition, pityriasis lichenoides is characterized by a band-like or lichenoid inflammatory infiltrate, especially in the acute PLEVA variant. And so this profile has been likened to the appearance of the umbrella thorn acacia, Vicalia tortilis, which is common in most parts of Africa as well as some parts of the Middle East. In the fullest expression of PLEVA, many of the characteristic findings can be seen at scanning magnification, including the presence of prominent neutrophilic crust, relatively prominent exocytosis of lymphocytes into the epidermis, known as a lymph in every hole or a lymph in nearly every vacuole, contributes to the obscuration of the dermal epidermal junction in the interface reaction typical of pityriasis lichenoides, as does prominent extravasated erythrocytes. In contrast to lichen planus or lichen planus-like keratoses or lichenoid purpura, pityriasis lichenoides is characterized by deep dermal perivascular and characteristic periadnexal extension of the lymphocytic infiltrate. And again, now along with a shameless plug for the Twitter monthly DermPath Journal Club, hashtag DermPathJC, the inverted wedge-shaped profile typical of pityriasis lichenoides at scanning magnification, with emphasis on not only perivascular but deep periadnexal extension of the lymphocytic infiltrate. In contrast to lichen planus, we typically do not see the sawtooth or jagged reedy ridges or the associated basilar squamatization. Reedy ridges tend to be rounded. In pityriasis lichenoides chronica, the inflammation tends to be sparser, so one is less likely to see neutrophilic crust, if at all, just maybe perhaps some perikeratosis. We still should be able to see some vacuolar interface changes, and here we can see characteristic extravasated erythrocytes and some lymphocyte exocytosis. And extension of the interface reaction with necrotic keratinocytes into adnexal epithelium, very characteristic of pityriasis lichenoides. So in summary, there's a very distinctive combination of findings in pityriasis lichenoides, including neutrophilic perikeratotic crust, exocytosis of lymphocytes, extravasated erythrocytes, and superficial and deep perivascular and periadnexal lymphocytic infiltrates with no eosinophils. And this brings us to the no eosinophils rule in interface dermatitis, which applies to pityriasis lichenoides as well as lupus and dermatomyositis. So eosinophils are rare or absent in these disorders. And looking here at a series of case reports of pityriasis lichenoides with histopathologic descriptions, we can see that in the vast majority of cases, the status of eosinophils is not mentioned. Only a couple of cases that mention the presence of eosinophils state that, but the other ones just don't address it at all. They don't say there's no eosinophils. So this has always been much more of a dermpath folklore rather than evidence-based dermatopathology. And the references here don't even really help, except perhaps by their consistent omission. And so it seems to be the case that it's very easy to not notice the absence of something and therefore not comment on it rather than a positive finding such as the presence of cells. And so several years ago, I did a deeper dive on this topic and surveyed recent textbooks and also found that this was also the case. Usually they're just not mentioned. And so I was grateful that I could drag some of my favorite colleagues, Drs. Vicky Sharon, Tom Konia, and Kira Barr, into a more detailed analysis of these cases. Determining the average eosinophil count in a variety of forms of interface dermatitis with the no eosinophils disorders listed in group 1 and group 2 containing disorders in which eosinophils might be expected, or at least, for example, in the case with lichen planus, the no eosinophils rule didn't necessarily apply. And we can see, in fact, that pityriasis lichenoides did have just about the lowest average eosinophil count of any of the disorders, 0.2, followed by dermatomyositis and cutaneous lupus, somewhere within the range of graft versus host disease, which is a disorder that's well known to not typically show eosinophils. The inevitable trade-off between diagnostic sensitivity and diagnostic specificity for this single histologic attribute, the eosinophil count, can be plotted as a receiver-operator characteristic curve, and this data can then be used to derive or evaluate cutoff criteria for the eosinophil count to determine which eosinophil count best distinguishes group 1 disorders versus group 2 disorders, again based on a single histologic attribute, the eosinophil count. And so here we can see that there are different places one can look. One could look at the intersection of sensitivity and specificity, but we chose to look at the area where the combined sensitivity and specificity is maximized, the known as the J statistic or Yowden index. And this was 1.1, or essentially 1. And we can see here that for the vast majority of group 1 disorders, the eosinophil count was indeed less than 1, as opposed to group 2 disorders, which had mostly average eosinophil counts above 1. So correct classification is maximized at 81% with a cutoff criteria of eosinophil count at 1.1. So then what is the definition of the eosinophil count? And that simply is the number of eosinophils in 10^20x fields, which we surmised was approximately the reasonable amount of effort a dermatopathologist in routine practice would spend looking for individual cells such as eosinophils. In other words, if you see even one eosinophil within 10^20x fields, then eosinophils are not rare or absent. Many other investigators have subsequently started to specifically address the presence or absence of eosinophils in their case series, and it seems to be that the no eosinophils rule does indeed hold up best for pityriasis lichenoides, with this very large series of pediatric pityriasis lichenoides cases recently published by one of, in my opinion, the top pediatric dermatopathologists in the world, Dr. Sylvie Freitag and colleagues, looking at over 71 cases over a decade's worth of experience. Eosinophils were assessed in every case and were not seen in any cases. I suspect that many clinicians can make a spot clinical diagnosis for this condition. Discoid lupus erythematosus, or DLE, the most common manifestation of chronic cutaneous LE. With other specific cutaneous manifestations of lupus erythematosus falling into the acute or subacute and neonatal categories. Nearly all forms of lupus show interface changes in concert with superficial and deep perivascular and characteristically periadnexal lymphocytic infiltrates. At scanning magnification, the infiltrates tend to be moderately dense and often bottom heavy, such that the balance or the greatest density of lymphocytes is in the mid to deep portion of the biopsy. There can be hyperkeratosis, which often is juxtaposed against atrophy of the nucleated epidermis and contiguous follicular epithelium. Eosinophils tend to be rare or absent, and other characteristic features include basement membrane thickening, which can be highlighted and confirmed using PAS stains, as well as increased interstitial dermal mucin. It's somewhat controversial whether the different acute, subacute, chronic lupus subsets can be independently distinguished on biopsy alone. There are some trends, but ultimately correlation with clinical and serologic features is required. More prominent epidermal changes, such as follicular plugging, basement membrane thickening, and deeper and denser infiltrates, tend to favor chronic cutaneous lupus, such as discoid lupus or tumid lupus or lupus paniculitis. And with the acute lesions, inflammation tends to be sparser, including the interface pattern of vacuolar interface changes rather than a dense lichenoid infiltrate. Here's one example of discoid lupus, looking a bit pinched in the mid portion, but we can still see that there is a moderately dense infiltrate, and it's somewhat denser than the infiltrate in the upper dermis. So this is that bottom heavy balance of the infiltrate that's so typical of lupus. And with discoid lupus, we do expect more epidermal changes. So we do indeed have some hyperkeratosis, follicular plugging, and we can see that amidst the hyperkeratosis and plugging, there's actually atrophy or thinning of the follicular epithelium and the interfollicular epidermis. Again, the balance of the infiltrate is mid to deep or bottom heavy, with follicular plugging being most characteristic of discoid lupus. At high magnification, we can see that the interface of the epidermis and underlying dermis is obscured by inflammation, junctional vacuoles, and dead reds. Basement membrane thickening, it's not always present, but when you have it, it's nice to have, because in the differential diagnosis of interface dermatitis, it's fairly specific. The only other disorder that I think is well documented to show basement membrane thickening in the interface group would be lichen sclerosis, but both lichen sclerosis and discoid lupus have a number of very distinctive features that separate them. Similarly, increased interstitial mucin in the dermis is nice to see in lupus, but not always present. And this can be a bit more subjective or difficult to interpret. I tend to like to restrict my interpretations to H and E with the thinking that if there's going to be enough mucin to be, you know, pathologically increased in a disease state, then it should be obvious on H and E. I don't feel like I need special stains to show me that increase. I found this study from Vincent and Chan at University of Michigan to be helpful in this regard. They looked at a number of cases of lupus and disorders that enter the clinical differential diagnosis with lupus and demonstrated that mucin in the papillary dermis is fairly nonspecific. The way I phrase it here is that it doesn't really count towards the diagnosis of lupus. Only increased interstitial mucin in the reticular dermis is diagnostically relevant. So we can see here that the p-values are only positive in the reticular dermis, both superficial and deep reticular dermis, not in the papillary dermis. No correlation with lupus and mucin in the papillary dermis. And although the mucin histochemical stains are quite pretty and certainly can increase your ability to detect low amounts of mucin, in clinical practice, again, my opinion is that the mucin stains are generally not necessary and that if there is a pathologically increased amount of mucin than it should be apparent on H&E. And again, remember, it's only one of a constellation of histologic features used to make the diagnosis of lupus or other connective tissue disorders. And a similar sentiment was expressed by one of the most experienced dermatopathologists in the world, Dr. Clay Cockerell, at the 2018 annual meeting of the American Society of Dermatopathology. I was fortunate to capture a bit of his comments.
Sustain on something that they say is rule out dermatomyositis or lupus, and it's positive, and then they give the patient the diagnosis of lupus, and they carry it around, and that's not in their best interest. So I think you have to be a little careful with mucin stains. I just think it's, most of the time, it's a waste of money.
Here we have two examples of acute cutaneous lupus with the characteristic butterfly or malar rash, and subacute cutaneous lupus, which often presents with annular or sometimes sericiform plaques, similar to neonatal lupus. Here is a biopsy of clinically confirmed subacute lupus, and we can see that there is an atrophic interface reaction. It seems to be centered around follicular epithelium, and there is some associated hyperkeratosis. It's not extending down as deep as a classic example of discoid lupus might. Note here that the eccrine glands are not involved, although in some examples of SCLE, they can be. And note that even though the overall infiltrate is superficial, it's still somewhat bottom heavy within the spectrum of tissue that is involved, with arguably a slight predominance of inflammation in the lower portions of this perifollicular infiltrate. And at higher magnification, the combined hyperkeratosis and atrophy that characterizes the atrophic interface reaction in most forms of lupus. Direct immunofluorescence, or DIF testing, represents an ancillary diagnostic modality that can sometimes help support a diagnosis of lupus. The lupus band is characterized by deposition of one or more immunoglobulins, or C3, the so-called full house. So we like to see at least two, if not more, immunoreactants along the dermal epidermal junction. The pattern can be shaggy or linear and granular, sometimes a combination of linear and granular along the junction. And one additional finding that can be assessed on DIF testing is the possibility of speckled nuclear epidermal IgG, which is most characteristic of mixed connective tissue disease, but also can be seen in lupus. High yield dermatology boards, what's your diagnosis? Dermatomyositis. So here's a question that I've been asked far more than once, shall we say? Well, in my estimation, the answer is not quite that simple, and perhaps that in part reflects the simplistic nature of the way the question was written. But sometimes the answer could be true, so I would say maybe. It depends. So for example, if one is asked to distinguish dermatomyositis from classic discoid lupus, I think you can do that. And I think in many instances, one can certainly favor one diagnosis or another. But ultimately, I think the answer is false in that I don't think that there are any differences, for example, between acute cutaneous lupus and dermatomyositis that would basically take precedence over clinical and serologic findings. So ultimately, I think in practice, the answer is false. Although in a test-taking situation, one certainly might be able to consistently make the correct educated guess. But overall, acute cutaneous lupus and dermatomyositis does tend to be the most commonly encountered and most challenging differential diagnosis. Both are characterized by fairly subtle infiltrates. Eosinophils are typically rare to absent in both. Both may have epidermal atrophy. One perhaps helpful point is that dermatomyositis is more likely to be restricted to acral skin, so that if you do get a biopsy from acral skin, it may favor dermatomyositis in that there's no other sites to biopsy, whereas a lupus patient may have involvement of the acral skin, but may be more likely to have non-acral sites to biopsy, and those would naturally be the preferred site of biopsy. So here with dermatomyositis, we can see the characteristic biopsy site reflected in the presence of acral skin, and we have a vacuolar interface dermatitis along the dermal epidermal junction. Not always obvious at scanning magnification due to the sparse or subtle nature that is typical of dermatomyositis, but at higher magnification, one can readily appreciate at least small numbers of necrotic keratinocytes and associated junctional vacuolar alteration. Erythema multiforme, EM, is well known for its classic targetoid lesions, often involving the palms. Bullous EM can be quite a bit more dramatic and require biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. Consistent with the acute and episodic nature of EM, typically the stratum corneum shows an undisturbed basket weave orthokeratotic pattern consistent with the acute onset. Necrotic keratinocytes are quite prominent to the extent that not only singled but clustered necrotic keratinocytes are typically present, and with progression one can see confluent necrosis and secondary subepidermal vesiculation. So this would be one mechanism of subepidermal blister formation. The associated inflammatory host response is typically relatively sparse and superficial, and mostly, if not exclusively, lymphocytic. Although the no eosinophils rule does not apply to EM, so sparse eosinophils or neutrophils can sometimes be seen. But the undisturbed basket weave orthokeratosis and very prominent necrotic keratinocytes are indeed hallmarks and expected features of EM, with the prominent necrosis reflected in both single and clustered necrotic cells. Here's one more clinical pathologic case from my old residency collection. And actually, I would say this case is not totally classic. It's classic in the sense that the biopsy was obtained from acral skin, but look, there's some perikeratosis. So this was biopsied at an uncharacteristically late stage of the disease process. And the inflammatory infiltrate's a little bit on the dense side. It's really kind of a sparse, patchy lichenoid infiltrate, which you wouldn't necessarily expect. But at higher magnification, the presence of numerous clusters of necrotic keratinocytes was supportive of the clinical setting of erythema multiforme in this case. And now a statement for your judgment. Skin biopsy distinguishes erythema multiforme, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and toxic epidermal necrolysis. True or false? Well, sometimes I've read in textbooks or heard that typically with TEN, the inflammation is going to be minimal to absent, whereas in Stevens-Johnson syndrome and EM, there may be more prominent inflammation. And that may generally be true, but ultimately, this question is similar to the one about lupus and dermatomyositis. You might be able to make a best educated and logical guess based on the path, but I don't think I'm ever going to see it overriding the clinical presentation and clinical features of the case. So ultimately, clinical correlation is required. With SJS patients typically presenting with mucosal involvement and much more likely to be systemically ill. Targetoid lesions when present are typically atypical, such as two-toned targets rather than classic targetoid lesions characteristic of EM. And toxic epidermal necrolysis, or TEN, presenting with much larger body surface area involvement with very superficial, minimal to non-inflammatory sloughing of the skin. A couple of images here courtesy of Dr. Art Huntley. Prominent single and clustered necrotic keratinocytes results in confluent epidermal necrosis and secondary subepidermal blister formation, all in the context of basket weave orthokeratosis, consistent with the fulminant onset that characterizes all of these disorders. Next case for diagnosis. If you don't have a specific diagnosis, can you recognize the clinical pattern? This happens to be graft versus host disease, but that's not possible to specifically diagnose from this image alone. The clinical pattern to recognize is that of a morbilliform eruption, which is also characteristic of drug and viral exanthems, among other less common possibilities, such as lupus. Graft versus host disease bears many similarities with and is essentially indistinguishable from erythema multiforme on histology alone, but additionally is characterized by adnexal epithelial involvement of the acute interface reaction. The no eosinophils rule does apply to GVHD, and there is also a grading system that is not specific, and to be honest, I can't remember the last time an oncologist or clinician asked me for this, but in the past, this would be somewhat regularly requested. These days, I only provide it upon request from the clinician, and again, I can't remember the last time a clinician asked me. And I would have to assume that the reason might be that the grading system has not proven to be clinically relevant over time. And this makes sense to me from a dermatopathologic perspective, because this grading system can be applied to any interface dermatitis. There is zero diagnostic specificity associated with this grading system. So in order to use the grading system, one must assume the diagnosis and then use the grading system to rate the severity. But we shouldn't flip it around the other way to say that if we have a grade for a biopsy, it doesn't mean that it's more likely to be GVHD versus another form of interface dermatitis. And here we see an acute interface reaction along the dermal epidermal junction, and we can see that there is some evidence of involvement of underlying follicular epithelium. We can see that the interface of the follicular epithelium and surrounding dermis is somewhat obscured by an inflammatory infiltrate, with specific evidence of interface dermatitis, necrotic keratinocytes, and junctional vacuolar alteration evident at the highest magnification. In contrast to acute lesions, in chronic GVHD lesions, the appearances may be more lichenoid, resembling lichen planus, and there's also a sclerodermoid subset with histologic features resembling morphea. Physicians caring for hospitalized patients know that morbilliform drug reactions are extremely common, and in the inpatient setting, a subset of critically ill patients will get a biopsy, either for diagnostic confirmation or the exclusion of other reaction patterns or infection. And I always thought that the interface pattern was most typical of drug reactions, but it turns out that spongiosis is probably at least as common, and perhaps most characteristically, the combination of both interface and spongiotic patterns, following the general rule that drug reactions can do anything, often combining patterns that non-drug reactions tend not to do. In terms of inflammation, it would seem to be the dogma, largely true, that eosinophils are typical of drug reactions, and so the presence of eosinophils is certainly suggestive, but ultimately not required for a drug reaction. It's the clinical correlation that is always required. Similarly, deep dermal involvement is said to be typical of drug reactions, but the absence of deep dermal involvement is by no means going to exclude one. Morbilliform viral exanthems are also relatively commonly encountered and can be quite difficult, sometimes impossible, to distinguish from the morbilliform drug reaction. Histologic features that are more suggestive of viral exanthems include relatively prominent lymphocyte exocytosis and extravasated erythrocytes with red blood cells present in the epidermis. These can be suggestive, but by no means definitive. Viral exanthems do have somewhat of a reputation for being relatively sparse or subtle, so within the spectrum of interface reactions, this is probably most likely to be viewed as somewhat of an invisible dermatosis, as discussed in that lecture. In the absence of other more distinctive findings, these red blood cells in the epidermis are suggestive. Which brings us to the final case for this session. Experienced and confident clinicians pause and diagnose. Fixed drug eruption. A most peculiar but distinctive form of drug reaction characterized by a solitary or small number of classically oval, sometimes annular patches that occur on the same site over and over again upon repeat exposure to the medication, with repeat episodes inducing post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation manifest histologically by increased melanophages. We also expect a mixed infiltrate with eosinophils or neutrophils and deep dermal perivascular extension, typical of most drug reactions. With bullous fixed drug reactions, there can be marked papillary dermal edema, and sometimes even confluent necrosis or subepidermal vesiculation is seen in EM. And interface changes are again most typical, but you can see spongiotic and perhaps most characteristically the combination of patterns, spongiotic and interface dermatitis. Here we see a relatively acute fixed drug reaction as evidenced by the presence of the basket weave orthokeratosis. There are prominent single and clustered necrotic keratinocytes with probably subclinical or microscopic evidence of a subepidermal cleft, probably not clinically evident. We have a lichenoid lymphocytic infiltrate and at least one eosinophil here. And with chronicity, increased melanophages. And so this concludes our summary of interface dermatitis. So remember to think about the pattern of inflammation, vacuolar interface versus lichenoid. This is actually somewhat of an artificial distinction, but if we do our best to maintain that distinction, we can think about erythema multiforme and acute and sometimes subacute forms of lupus, acute GVHD, and many drug and viral exanthems on the vacuolar interface side. And then with the dense or lichenoid band-like infiltrates, think about the prototype lichen planus and its mimic LPLK, some drug reactions, more subacute to chronic manifestations of lupus, chronic GVHD, lichenoid purpura, pityriasis lichenoides, also lichen striatus, and the focal lichenoid infiltrates of lichen nidditis, which sometimes have granulomatous features. And we didn't talk about syphilis, but of course that's a great mimicker, so that is classically psoriasiform and lichenoid combined pattern, typically with plasma cells, not to be missed. Of course, the complete assessment of interface dermatitis depends not only on the pattern of inflammation, but a composite assessment of the pattern along with associated epidermal changes and the composition of the inflammatory infiltrate and sometimes other attributes. And so this table summarizes key features for the different disorders covering all of these aspects, pattern, epidermal changes, inflammatory cells. It's far from perfect. You definitely don't want me to read through this table today. We don't really have time, but as always, anything here is open for discussion or questions, so please bring it up in the discussion after the lecture or leave in the comments below. And for those of you who just can't get enough of interface dermatitis, here's one last question for you to ponder as we transition over to the discussion. I just can't get enough. I just can't get enough.